Oh, Congress, it's that time again. We've been seeing, and now we're saying, just like we promised to continue to do. Let's see, where to start this week? How about the fact that for the first time in our memory, Russia looks like a country with more liberty than our great America? For the first time in American memory, the Russian president displays more common sense and decency than any single one of you, sitting in Congress, doing nothing but fattening your purses with bribes and paybacks, passing atrocious laws you don't read, and then making sure they don't apply to you. On February 4th, 2013, Vladimir Putin, the Russian president, he's the real one, by the way, not a foreign imposter placed in Russia's capital by George Soros and company, addressed the Duma, Russian parliament, and gave a speech about the tensions with minorities in Russia. Quote, "In Russia, live Russian. Any minority from anywhere, if it wants to live in Russia, to work and eat in Russia, should speak Russian and should respect the Russian laws. If they prefer Sharia law, then we advise them to go to those places where that's the state law. Russia does not need minorities. Minorities need Russia. And we will not grant them special privileges or try to change our laws to fit their desires, no matter how loud they yell discrimination. We better learn from the suicides of America, England, Holland, and France if we are to survive as a nation. The Russian customs and traditions are not compatible with the lack of culture or the primitive ways of most minorities. When this honorable legislative body thinks of creating new laws, it should have in mind the national interest first, observing that the minorities are not Russians." Unquote. The politicians in the Duma gave Putin a standing ovation for 5 minutes. It would seem that unlike the United States Congress, Supreme Court, and this dismal circus we're calling the Obama administration, Mr. Putin understands what it means to protect and serve his people. You people, on the other hand, are quite busy serving another master, aren't you? Last week, a document circulated the internet virally, a document which was a letter originating from UNODA, United Nations Office for Disarmament Affairs, to the Disarmament Commission Civilian Weapons Confiscation Study Group, dated at the top August 5th, 2013. Just in case some of you can't read, and we suspect, given the common statement among you, that you pass bills to find out what's in them instead of reading them, that may be the case. We will read it out loud here. That may also be quite helpful to the blind Americans who are listening to this video. For those who can't read or hear, pictures convey 1,000 words. But for those who can't see, audible words mean everything. Oh yeah, words mean everything anyway, don't they? Words like the following. Disarmament Commission Civilian Weapons Confiscation Study Group, New York, 29 through 31, July 2013. The issue of military-grade weaponry in the hands of civilians looms ever larger in the face of the global implementation of 22/Agenda 21 by member nations. In particular, the United States of America has an estimated 500 million weapons in the hands of its civilian population. This is not just a static problem, it is a massive dynamic problem for the process of confiscation, as there will be those who refuse to surrender their firearms. The conclusion of discussions by the CWCSG led to the adoption of a proposed agenda to begin the process for introducing to member nations a framework by which they can begin codification of national laws to disarm civilians within their borders through a graduated process. Within the discussion framework, we have identified several problem areas that must be addressed. They are 1. Classification of military-grade weapons to be made illegal for possession. 2. Creation of programs to provide reasonable compensation for voluntary surrender of said arms. 3. Codification of laws to begin the restricting and strict licensing of concealable firearms. 4. Codification of laws to begin the restricting and strict licensing of hunting-grade firearms. 5. Codification of laws to restrict the sale of and possession of ammunition and components to manufacture ammunition. 6. Finally, codification of laws to completely make and all firearms illegal to own, possess, or use outside of military and law enforcement usage. 7. Creation of a United Nations Police Task Force with the specific mission of assisting member nations with the collection of weaponry from civilian hands. The CWCSG will submit its findings and final recommendations once we have created the codification framework for member nations for a full review by the Office of the Secretary General. Of course, the UN denies that UNODA issued this letter, as is to be expected, since even our own American presidents have set an accepted precedent when caught with their pants down around their ankles and their hands on various and sundry honeypots. The immediate claim that I have done nothing wrong, nothing to see here, move along, has worked. Not anymore. Even if, by some remote possibility, that the letter is not genuine, its contents are. One only needs to read the Agenda 21 document, which is based entirely on socialist control mechanisms, to know that global disarmament and the rendering of every single civilian individual throughout the world to a defenseless state is paramount to its completion. It also outlines some other objectives, such as an end to national sovereignty, the abolition of private property, the restructure of the family unit, absolute restrictions on mobility and opportunity, the concentration of humans into human settlement zones, as is indicated quite clearly on the map proposed for the agenda in America. The list goes on. So while America was sleeping, their president, the original American Nazi, George H.W. Bush, sold them to the global elite. While they were watching the mind control machine, drinking the poisoned water, dosing themselves with toxic chemicals presented as pharmaceutical wonder drugs, and believing themselves protected by the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, another traitor in the White House was swearing their allegiance to a foreign body and dissolving their country and its national sovereignty without their knowledge or consent. The people didn't have a clue what this criminal was actually doing, but those of you in Congress did. You knew then, and you know now. Agenda 21, though, is nothing more than the end game, the final solution to a plan older than most living Americans. Congress has been very busy deconstructing this nation for just about 100 years now. There are many other documents finally available for public perusal, which outline the intention to disarm the American people. Let's look at a few of them. In 1961, the U.S. Government Printing Office published the United States Program for General and Complete Disarmament in a Peaceful World, publication number 7277. In that document, very clear statements are made, such as, first, there must be immediate disarmament action. All disarmament obligations must be subject to effective international controls. Adequate peacekeeping machinery must be established. This can only be achieved through the progressive strengthening of international institutions under the United Nations and by creating a United Nations peace force to enforce the peace as a disarmament process proceeds, the disbanding of all national armed forces, the elimination from national arsenals of all armaments. The document goes on to describe this idiotic plan in three stages. The real nitty-gritty of it comes in stage three. The manufacture of armaments would be prohibited except for those of agreed types and quantities to be used by the UN Peace Force and those required to maintain internal order. All other armaments would be destroyed or converted to peaceful purposes. So, according to this document, the only way to ensure the peace and safety of the people of the whole damn planet is to render them defenseless and dependent upon Big Daddy UN. Dependent for their personal protection, beg Big Daddy for solutions to their every dispute, and hope Big Daddy favors their position over the other guys. It goes without saying they aren't supposed to notice that Big Daddy is the same entity promoting, enabling, and facilitating war and genocide across the globe. The same communist-controlled entity with the same absurd and moronic idea that social justice is a viable concept. It's beginning to look like the drug culture of the 60s that produced these idiots is still ongoing. Either they've never stopped rolling up and lighting up, or they are suffering daily LSD flashbacks. Somehow, the communists of the 60s, who now much prefer to be called modern progressives, missed the whole dismal outcome for the nations that espoused and instituted Karl Marx's deadly utopian fantasy. Those of us with an ounce of common sense left understand that social justice is just another touchy-feely way to describe the reality of the term slavery, whereby the entire population of the earth is reduced to the living standard of the poorest, most destitute among us. While the elite, all-knowing, all-caring debauchery addicts play Big Daddy, they insidiously take over all our educational institutions and media outlets, terminally infecting our halls of governance from the town hall to the White House with their insanity. Progressivism isn't about progress. It's about regression and transformation from a modern, evolving, albeit slower than we'd like, society based on freedom and liberty, back in time to an era of feudal control by the few slave masters over the whole of humanity. In fact, what they have in mind is going to be much, much worse. Then came a real humdinger. Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, discovered quite by accident on July 7, 1986. Despite numerous attempts to claim the document was fake, it was indeed authenticated. What's in that document? Oh, nothing important, unless you consider the details of a plan hatched in the embryonic days of the Cold War, which called for control of the masses through manipulation of industry, people's pastimes, education, and political leanings to be a little more alarming than, say, a level 5 hurricane. The plan called for a quiet revolution, pitting brother against brother and diverting the public's attention from what is really going on. By the time this document was made virally available and became widely read, most of the agenda had been accomplished. The document outlined exactly how they were going to do it, and do it they have. All of our major industry has been moved to other nations. Most of America is watching outlandishly stupid television programming instead of reading or actually participating in real life. Disgusting grievance pushers like Al Sharpton, Jesse Jackson, and a dozen others even within Congress, not to mention the racist in chief in the White House, make millions of dollars off the suffering of the dumbed-down minorities in order to propagate, promote, and maintain division. Just as the document described in detail, our family units are being destroyed. Mommy has to work just to put food on the table, while Daddy either never makes an appearance or is now wearing the lace thongs and wonder bras. The children are not only indoctrinated by a constant barrage of revolting and morally bankrupt values under the guise of federal programs like Common Core, but are forcefully controlled with psychotropic drugs to ensure their unwavering robotic performance and attention to the mind control in the classroom. But the classroom isn't enough. Now they're being chipped to ensure that the control mechanisms operate 24 hours a day. Babies are murdered routinely by so-called humanitarian doctors and medical hacks under the guise of Planned Parenthood. The details of selective parenting and government child rearing are also laid out quite well in the document. Americans now think that they cannot survive without a massive Big Brother babysitter telling them when to visit the toilet, and are rapidly becoming exactly what the twisted elites say they are: useless eaters. From food stamps to Obamaphones, they line up to get their doggy treats for doing nothing more than rolling over and playing dead. Our sons and daughters in the military are being taught that our founders and colonial ancestors were terrorists, racists, and mass murderers in order to convince them that declaring their homeland to be a battleground and their families the enemy is justified, in the hopes that they won't question their orders when told to assault their own or somebody else's grandmother who has somehow escaped the mass hypnosis and is standing her ground for her God-given rights. That brings us to another document, Air War College, Command and Control of Military Forces in the Homeland, 2008. This one's a gem. It outlines how to achieve through deceit and trickery under the pretext of proper response and capability in times of natural disasters. They will militarize all current law enforcement, national and state guards, sheriffs, local police, to create the perfect police state. Unfortunately, that one has been underway for a long, long time. From the moment the decision was made in 1947 to launch the biggest cover-up in history, the writing was on the wall. Too bad we didn't listen when Presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy tried to warn us. Now we have Neanderthal thugs in police officer uniforms, now there's an oxymoron, murdering old men and children, aiding in the mass theft of private property, shredding the Constitution and Bill of Rights, and slobbering at the feet of their masters, hoping for a pat on the head and a new drone. Oh goodness, let's not forget this one. Army. W10-35. The Civilian Inmate Labor Program, issued by Headquarters Department of the Army, Washington, D.C., January 14, 2005. This one just sends a tingle up our legs when we think how tenderly our government and military plan to take care of us. They tell us right off the bat what their real purpose is in this lovely global plan for social justice. Provides Army policy and guidance for establishing civilian inmate labor programs and civilian prison camps on Army installations. Discusses sources of federal and state civilian inmate labor. This regulation applies to the active Army National Guard of the United States and the U.S. Army Reserve, unless otherwise stated. Even if this one is in reference to current federal, state, and local prisoners at this time, it sure goes a long way toward explaining why America has the largest prison population in the world, made up mostly of nonviolent, victimless crime. Now, we all know these prisons are actually privately owned corporations, trading the prisoners on the open market as securitized assets, just like the mortgage-backed toxic derivatives, but that's another whole video, isn't it? This document also shows us exactly where the idea of the FEMA prison camps came from, why they are currently being staffed, stocked, and made ready for the next government-planned disaster or fake war. We aren't stupid, Congress. In fact, most of us are a good deal brighter than any of you, which is why we are your bosses and you are our servants. We recognize crematorium smokestacks, triple fencing, and razor wire angled in rather than out are all designed to ensure that those who enter do not leave. If you think that the silly actions performed by your thugs in Boston, New Orleans, or other places shown on all the news stations is how the real deal is going to go down, you are in for a major shock. We know, and we aren't going. You can leave those shackled rail cars and all those buses parked right where they are. Gee, where have we seen this plan before? Oh, yes. It was 1930s Hitler's Germany. Of course, before that sawed-off little maniac could march millions of people onto his trains and to his forced labor and death camps, he had to do what? That's right, disarm them. Only disarmed and helpless people willingly board the bus to the slaughter. The people of Germany may have been stupid, or just naive, who knows, but we can tell you we're not. Keep those FEMA camps operational, though, because we're going to need a place to put all of you while we arrange for that which you do not deserve, but as principled Americans we must provide due process of law and a fair trial by a jury of your peers, if you have any. Just a side note. We aren't missing the irony of the fact that this whole plan actually got hatched simultaneously with Hitler and his genocide. It really all began in the 30s with technocracy. Some of you might be too young to even know about that one. Still trying to deny what you're up to, Congress? Really? Well, let's move on with the documents then, shall we? FM 3-39.40, Internment and Resettlement Operations, February 2010, Headquarters, Department of the Army. This one has a nice ring to it, doesn't it? We mustn't miss the destruction notice on the bottom of the cover page. Destroy by any method that will prevent disclosure of contents or reconstruction of the document. God forbid this should end up in the hands of the people, right? Once again, a picture paints a thousand words. Here is the structure of the plan. Nice little abbreviations there. What is that one on the left? CIs? Grouped with enemy combatants? We already know you have declared all patriots and wide awake Americans, to be your enemies. Ah, okay. CIs are civilian internees, of course. That makes perfect sense. Now we see the ongoing purpose of the earlier documents outlining the detention of we the people when we finally get wise to criminal actions of who? You. Then you move on to the EPWs, and who are they? Oh, just the usual good American patriot, like members of the armed forces who didn't succumb to the indoctrination and brainwashing, members of all militias, state and local, Tea Party members or others who belong to any organization still holding a firm belief in God and country, anybody openly carrying a firearm, never mind they have every right in the world to do so, anybody carrying a sign you don't like, and we really love this one, members of regular armed forces operations who profess allegiance to a government or an authority not recognized by the detaining power. Detaining power? Just who in the hell do you think you are, and who died and put you in charge of a single one of us? There is not a single one of you intelligent enough to be assuming to be qualified to tell even the least of us what to do or how to do it. This great nation was designed for the federal level to be on the bottom, never on the top. Only God has authority over the people. End of story. You are on the bottom of the totem pole, and rightly so. Thomas Jefferson was a brilliant man who made many a brilliant statement, but he never made a statement more accurate and blatantly obvious than this one. When government fears its people, you have liberty. When the people fear their government, you have tyranny. It's more than obvious you fear us in the extreme, and you should, because we also paid close attention when Mr. Jefferson instructed us to throw off the yoke of tyrannical government and institute new governance from time to time in order to preserve that which has been bestowed upon all creatures, great and small, the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Rights are not issued by governments and cannot be taken away by any man. Government can only grant or rescind privileges, not rights. And we the people do know the difference, even if you think we don't. What else does the document say about EPWs? Inhabitants of an unoccupied territory who on the approach of the enemy spontaneously take up arms to resist the invading forces without having had time to form themselves into regular armed units, provided they carry arms openly and respect the laws and customs of war. How very interesting that you identify yourselves as the enemy of we the people in this section, and also as the invading forces. Or are you talking about the hundreds of thousands of foreign troops you already have on our soil, stupid enough to attempt to take on a massively armed civilian populace? Talking about your convenient cannon fodder there, are you? Don't miss the note at the bottom of the section of the document. We don't need much more of a hint that our so-called government views we the people as their property first and their enemy second. If there's any doubt left of the egregious and murderous purpose of Agenda 21, one need only look at the next document up for discussion. Future strategic issues, future warfare, circa 2025. The gloves are completely off in this one. This is the outline of how they intend to wage war against the people of the earth from this time forward, up to and after 2025. You sick, twisted bastards really think your transhumanism plans are going to render us all into bots, Borgs, and humans? Good luck on that one. Who are all the entities involved in this whack job plan? Wow. What a lineup, huh? You think you'll still be pushing the phony global warming scam in 2025? You think by then we are going to let you crossbreed us with animals? You people are stark raving mad if you think we're not aware and prepared to stop your insanity. It seems, according to the document, you're planning to use airborne varieties of Ebola, Lassa, etc., binary agents, genomically targeted pathogens, etc., on us between now and then. Oh, sort of like what you're claiming the Syrian government is doing, but in reality you are doing to convince us to support World War III. Forget it, guys and gals. The minority entitlement junkies will be of no use to you, and the rest of us are already aware. You'll have no trouble stirring up the Middle Eastern barbarians with promises of 72 virgins in exchange for their sorry lives, but no thanks. We don't need your virgins, and we can't think of a single one of you worth dying for. If they really want to kill each other over there, we say let them. It's obvious they'll never move out of the Dark Ages anyway, and we sure don't want their ideologies or Sharia law here. However, we are not going to put up with any more of this arming our enemies, such as you've already sanctioned and turned a blind eye to. No more bribing of the enemy like Obama has done with Morsi and the Muslim Brotherhood on our dime. It's you we're going to hold responsible. Rein in your mongrel or end up in the dung heap with him. Let's scroll through some more of what is outlined in the document. Oh yeah, we've known about your smart dust, nanotags, and co-opted insects. Mork Allen's ring a bell? For quite some time now. We are fully aware of what you are currently putting in the chemtrails too. And we're aware of exactly when you, Congress, signed permission for we the people to be used as guinea pigs for biological warfare testing without our consent or knowledge. How dare you feed the American people your complete bullshit story about the Syrians and what they're doing when you have devised what you call a wholly new class of weaponry which is legal, that includes mechanized dust which bores into lung tissue and executes various pathological missions. Perhaps when we the people put you in the prison camps you meant for us, we should test your legal new weapon on you. You know, sort of like Hitler's showers. Just to make sure it works as intended. Wouldn't want any of those fingerprintless symptoms to be left out, now would we? Nice to know you've been at this since Operation White Coat in the 50s and 60s. How many Americans have you killed or crippled since then? Are you not aware that the assessment of the value of humans applies to you, too? Do you think your bodies are any different than ours, or that we aren't going to see to it that you find out how wrong you are? You're way ahead of schedule with the CNN syndrome, aren't you? Ah, capture, torture Americans in living color on prime time. Does Ambassador Stevens and Benghazi come to mind? Terror attacks within. You've really overdone that one. 9/11, Boston, plus all the fakery involving so-called domestic terrorists like Waco, Oklahoma City, Aurora, Colorado, Sandy Hook, and on. Just so you know, should any EMP happen anywhere, we know where to point the finger. What a rosy future you have planned. Simultaneous, ongoing revolutions in all three major warfare metrics. Don't you think our participation is going to be needed? Oh, we'll probably participate, all right, but not the way you think we will. Your monumental idiocy is right there in black and white on page 113, where you attempt to predict our reactions to this information. Is in the too hard box. Not being done yet by anyone, therefore, will not be done. They would not do that. We have to hope they would not do that. Why go there? Can't defend against it. Some disbelief, but agreement, there is too much there to disregard. And we thought the entitlement junkie sheep were brain dead. You people take the cake. There's another document all Americans need to read and follow the links within it. The New Order of the Barbarians, New World Order Plans Exposed by Insider, 1969. No wonder you boys, or we refuse to refer to any of you as ladies, despise whistleblowers so much. It must suck mightily when the pawns rebel. The contents page shows the agenda all laid out nice and neat. All those plans leading to Agenda 21, and that we see you forcing down our throats right now. See anything on this list that isn't blatantly obvious on the street? The success of such a revolting and nauseating agenda would only work if the hapless victims didn't catch on. Well, guess what? You can inform your bosses for us. You know, those old fat, hideous bankers that think technology is going to let them live forever. We're not their property. We're not their cattle. And we're not going to bow down to you. One of the most important things Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. ever had to say was, "There comes a time when a moral man can't obey a law his conscience tells him is unjust. That time has come, and we will not obey." Oh, for goodness sake, we almost forgot Iron Mountain, a blueprint to tyranny. In 1961, the Kennedy administration ordered a top-secret study to determine the problems facing the United States if the world moved from an era of war to a golden age of peace. The study group consisted of 15 so-called academics, and the first and last meetings were held at an underground nuclear survival retreat called Iron Mountain. The study was concluded in 1966. By then, President Lyndon Johnson, one of the chief players in the murder of John F. Kennedy, gave the order that the report was never to be released. Fortunately for us, even back then, there were men of conscience involved, and one of them released it under the name John Doe. Yep, a good old-fashioned whistleblower. Naturally, the imposter American government tried to dismiss it as a hoax after its publishing, but looking back today at the contents of that report, its authenticity is undeniable. This is a very deep look into the empty soul of the New World Order. Iron Mountain is the covert agenda to bring the world and America under the control of the United Nations. All of the conclusion reached are now being implemented upon the American people, many of them entirely oblivious as to what is happening and what. For all Americans who are not yet aware of the contents of this outline of evil and murderous intent, we recommend a documentary available on YouTube, Iron Mountain, Blueprint to Tyranny. Don't think we buy the, "Oh, you can't avoid it because the Bible says so," either. We know how the plan works to follow the Bible and make it look like biblical prophecy we can't avoid. Dumb move. Do you empty gene pool refugees really think we don't know you always create the problem and the solution? The bad guy and the good guy? The world of war and the so-called golden age movement? Those drugs you're on must be world-class hallucinogens if you think we don't know that both roads lead to hell and we'll just buy your savior story. We now see all those uniforms as equal. They're all the enemy in the war you have declared against we the people, and we will act accordingly. All your artificial intelligence plans, NSA spying, microchipping, thuggery is for naught because you failed to recognize the one truth about us. We are the human species, and there is no amount of computer data which will ever allow you to accurately anticipate the outcome and consequences of an all-out attack on the human spirit. We'll give you credit for recognizing in Silent Weapons document that women were the greatest threat because they're mothers and therefore totally unpredictable. But that's where you screwed up. Your plans were cooked up by men. And even if you'd been able to fathom the depths of the female mind, you would still have failed because you shortchanged the men as well in your assumption that you could bribe your way or frighten your way to totalitarian world control and hold it. No government of any kind ever has or ever will exist and persist without the consent of the people. It doesn't matter what you do. The human species will only tolerate just so much before they decide to fight, and then you have a big, big problem on your hands. But of course, you know that, don't you? That's the very purpose of the sudden false flag events like Aurora and Sandy Hook and Boston, isn't it? You can't pull this off to completion without disarming America. You've been told by your handlers that you'd better find a way to get us to straighten up and fly right under the UN Small Arms Treaty, haven't you? All your idiotic rhetoric, fake crisis, and phony baloney news campaigns have been for naught. You will never convince us to hand over our guns, so instead you sit there like a bunch of neutered slugs, while the slime ball with the golf clubs signs unlawful and unconstitutional executive orders, like you think will let you off the hook, when you say, oh, we tried. Yeah? Well, here's the deal, Congress. We know who is voting to accept that treaty, and we know just who to hold accountable first. Let's play name the traitor, shall we? The 46 senators that recently voted to give our rights, which they have no authority to give in the first place, to the UN, all pinheaded Democrats, of course, not that Republicans aren't equally pinheaded, but they're traditionally and historically a lot sneakier and cowardly than Democrats. Democrats are like teenagers on crack with a death wish, in your face with their lunacy, waving their fists like they actually have the power to force their will on us. Baldwin of Wisconsin, Baucus of Montana, Bennett of Colorado, Blumenthal of Connecticut, Boxer of California, Brown of Ohio, Cantwell of Washington, Cardin, Maryland, Carper, Delaware, Casey, Pennsylvania, Coombs, Delaware, Cowan, Massachusetts, Durbin, Illinois, Feinstein, California, no surprise there, Franken, Minnesota, Gillibrand of New York, Harkin of Iowa, Hirono of Hawaii, Johnson of South Dakota, Kane of Virginia, King of Maine, Klobuchar of Minnesota, Landrieu of Louisiana, Lehi of Vermont, Levin of Michigan, McCaskill of Missouri, Menendez of New Jersey, Merkley of Oregon, McCluskey of Maryland, Murphy of Connecticut, Murray of Washington, Nelson in Florida, Reed of Rhode Island, Reed of Nevada, what a puss, huh? Rockefeller of West Virginia, Sanders of Vermont, Schatz of Hawaii, Schumer of New York, Shaheen of New Hampshire, Udall of New Mexico, Warner of Virginia, Warren of Massachusetts, Whitehouse of Rhode Island, and Wyden of Oregon. The real terrorists are wearing suits and using fakery in their pathetic attempt to manipulate us into supporting their actions. The real terrorists are in the halls of Congress and on our television screens every day, all day. The real terrorists use fantasy and fear on a daily basis to destroy this nation and its people. Now they're trying to convince us that another war, a third world war, started by us in the Middle East, is the necessary way to go on the false claim of chemical attacks actually set up by our own government against the Syrian people. No more, Congress. You kill any more innocent people on foreign soil, you will do it in your name, not ours. We will not participate. We will shout to the rooftops who the aggressors are and who those foreign nations should hunt down like mad dogs and hold accountable. Count on it. That's all for now, Congress. Until next time. We have a whole lot more seeing and saying to do. Your individual crimes should be interesting to explore in a video, don't you think? Which one of you shall we start with? See you next time. And until then, don't forget, we are the answer. Oops, Just a little PS for the people. We know about the planned bail-in already in place for the next big bank collapse. Thanks for the heads up in Greece. Everybody should remove their money, all their money from the big banks yesterday. They're going to take your funds to cover their massive gambling debts from the fraudulent mortgage-backed toxic derivatives, just like they did in Greece, but a whole lot bigger. You will pay for their crimes, and you will suffer for their greed. You've been warned. Take your money from them now, or lose it to them later.